I'm Clay Pigeon. Welcome to the Wake and Bake Morning Show podcast. It's a weekly digest of some of the segments and moments that make up the Wake and Bake Morning Show on WFMU. Of course, you can listen live to Wake and Bake Monday through Friday, 6 to 9 a.m. Eastern on WFMU.org. Join me live every morning for the full show. It includes great music, chair throwing, pixie dust, and all-around good vibes.
Oh my God, the man is a maniac.
You can also hear the full show on streaming archives at WFMU.org/playlists/WA.
If your lunch doesn't last you the whole day through, I'm Denny Moore with a great beef stew. It makes a good dinner, but I've got a hunch. Why wait for dinner? Have it for lunch. It's meat and potatoes, good lean beef with a gravy rich beyond belief. Just try my stew. I've got a hunch. You're gonna like having dinner for lunch. Look for my thumbprint on every can and have dinner for lunch.
Well, what are the kids having to eat in the Hoboken school system today on this Friday, September 6th? Well, this looks pretty good. Do you like some of that barbecue pulled pork? I think it's pretty good. But there's a catch. I went to DrAxe.com and found out a few things. I mean, why wouldn't you want pulled pork? Well, pork's one of the most widely eaten meats in the world. 38% of all the meat we eat is pig. Delicious pig. Some say pigs are the waste disposals of the farm, eating any and every disgusting thing they can find. Bugs, insects, dead carcasses of sick animals, their own young, feces. In one case, even the farmer who raised them. Plus, and listeners, this is big. Pigs can't sweat. No glands for it, so they're full to the snout with toxins. Delicious pigs. Now, along with that pulled pork, coleslaw today in the Hoboken school system. Coleslaw been around since ancient Rome. In fact, the term coleslaw comes from the Dutch word koolslaw. Remember that? Which was a shortened version of the term cool salad, which literally meant cabbage salad. And it tastes so good. Even though, because bugs love cabbage, your slaw might contain various parts of diamondback moths, little pieces of cabbage worms in your coleslaw, beet army worms, flea beetles, cut worms, cabbage aphids. You're eating them. But they are good sources of protein. Coleslaw, pulled pork, and a bun. Gotta have your bun. Bun's innocent, right? I went to Telegraph at UK.com. Everybody loves buns. Come on. But the man bun is making men bald. Have you heard about this? Dr. Sabra Sullivan, a leading U.S. dermatologist, warns men that constantly pulling back their hair into those man buns puts too much pressure on follicles of your scalp and can result in rapidly receding hairlines and a thing called traction alopecia. Buns. There's your school lunch.
I'm a bun. I'm a tasty, tasty bun to be baked and eaten. Oh, how fun. You can have me with breakfast, have me with lunch. You can have me with your dinner, you can have me with your lunch. I'm a bun.
I'm a tasty, tasty bun
to be baked and to be kneaded. Oh,
how my name's fun. Gary Tidwell, and I'm as country as they come. My name is Gary Tidwell, and I come from Tennessee. And I ain't got much in this world except my guitar and me. And if some old boy asks me where I'm from, I say I'm from down in Tennessee. I'm as country as they come. Don't go in for city ways. I love my dungarees. cowboy boots are new and stiff, but that don't bother me. I'll put a pinch between my cheek and gum. That's how they do it in Tennessee. I'm as country as they come. I got a TV and I got a dog in a rusted pickup truck. I ran out on my wife and son, that's when I run out of luck. I dip into my pouch and roll some drum. I drank myself to sleep, cause I'm as country as they come. I live across from the Dairy Queen.
Good morning, everybody. It's time for Food Stuff with me, Wendy Del Formaggio. Pull yourself up a chair and let's talk about ways to cook food in liquid and what the terms mean. What's the difference between poaching and boiling? And what the hell is sous vide?
I don't know.
Poaching is a slow, low-temperature method where the food is completely submerged. It's a good choice for eggs, pears, or more delicate lean meats like chicken breast or fish. The liquid must stay ideally at about 180 degrees Fahrenheit max, with just a bubble or two simming up from the bottom. Simmering is more intense than poaching. The water gets hot enough to create small bubbles, but it's not a full rolling boil, so you have to stare at it to make sure the water doesn't get too hot.
Oh, it's too hot.
It can be annoying.
Too hot, lady.
Most food, other than starches like grains, potatoes, and pasta, don't want to get boiled.
Aww.
It kills the flavor, texture, and nutrients. Steaming involves boiling liquid, but the food sits above the pool in a basket or rack, and you put a lid on the pot to trap the steam. Steaming is used to cook shellfish and vegetables because you can get the job done without overcooking the food or interfering with its flavor, and you don't need fat or oil.
Woo!
Blanching is hot and fast. You drop the food into boiling water for mere seconds before yanking it out. It's great for delicate vegetables like asparagus.
Delicious.
Or for nearly any fresh fruit or vegetable you want to freeze. It makes for better flavor and texture. Blanching is also a good way to loosen thin skins of produce you want to peel, like tomatoes or grapes.
Goofy Grape here! Hello!
Sous vide, French for under vacuum, is tricky.
Tricky, 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 tricky.
It involves sealing food in a plastic bag and cooking it from 1 to 48 hours in a water bath at a steady temperature. This is not boil in a bag. The water is 140 degrees or less.
Okay.
The benefits of sous vide are excellent moisture retention and even thorough cooking. The pain in the butt part is finding a bag that won't melt or release endocrine disruptors into your food, and finding an inexpensive device to carefully maintain a low temperature. I hear a crock pot's warm setting might achieve that, but I haven't tried it. Maybe you should, and let us know how it goes. That's it for me. Back to you, Clay.
Thanks, Wendy. You'll hear food stuff at 7:35 each Thursday on Wake and Bake. And Wendy's got her own show, The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald. It airs Monday, 8 to 10 Eastern on Brattleboro Community Radio, WVEW.org. Music continues this morning on Wake and Bake. This is Radiohead. And no surprises. I'm glad you're with me, listener. Thanks for making us part of your life.
What's your name, man?
Richard Gonzalez.
Richard, I noticed you right away because you got a lot of tats. Now, a lot of people have a lot of tats these days. When I grew up, it was mostly still sailors and people like that. And I thought, well, it's going to be a fad back in the 90s, but it stuck around. Why do you think it hasn't gone away this time?
I mean, the tattoo community and industry has just grown so big right now. Like, it's become more common. It's become less frowned upon. It's just become more mainstream.
It's accepted now.
Yeah, exactly.
If you try to get a job in New York, nobody says anything about it?
No, yeah. I don't really see any issues about it. Like, everybody's just chill about it over here.
And you have some piercings, too, in the nose. And what do you call the ear things, the large rings?
Plugs or gauges.
Now, if you decided I'm tired of those things, would your earlobes ever recover back to normal?
I could get them stitched up, and it would be basically back to normal, or just take them off and let them close by themselves.
So there's a corrective procedure for that?
Yeah.
Can I ask your age?
34.
I want you to know, man, I've got no judgment at all.
No, you're good, Bobby.
I'm not making fun of you or anything like that.
No, you're good.
So are you involved in the tattoo industry? Are you a tattoo artist yourself?
I'm not, but I grew up in the tattoo industry. Most of my friends do tattoos or piercings and stuff like that. I grew up in that.
Is there a camaraderie inside a tattoo parlor? Is there a feeling like you're all in something together or shared interest kind of thing?
Yeah, it's like a family, basically. Everybody works together. Everybody helps each other out. You make lots of friends in the tattoo industry and the tattoo community. And everybody's just very friendly for the most part.
I'm guessing with the amount you have, what percentage of your body would you say is covered at this point?
About a 70%.
And do you feel like you're done?
No. I still got a long way to go.
Is it addictive?
I wouldn't say addictive. It's just depending, like, the person. Like, I like it, and I'm all about it, so it's just something that I have set as a goal to, like, be completely covered.
Of the individual tats you have, are there any that you regret or maybe wouldn't have now?
I really don't regret any at all at this point.
You have them on your face. Was that a big step for you? Did you think about that? That seems to be a dividing line for a lot of people. We're like, oh, man, I don't know if I can do that.
I did. It took me a while to decide if I was going to get it or not. I moved out from my family's place and did my own thing before I decided to get them, you know what I mean?
Does anybody in your life wish you didn't, like your parents? Or?
I mean, they don't hate me for it. They obviously wish I wouldn't have got them, but they accept me and they love me how I am.
What would you advise a kid maybe 18 years old and they're thinking about it? Do you have any advice for them?
Yeah, don't be in a rush and think things through before you do it. Don't just try to get tattoos just to try to impress people. Just think about it before you do it, because your opinion and your way of thinking is going to change so much. What you like now may not be the same thing you're going to like a few years from now.
I appreciate your time, Matt, and I wish you all the best. And they look great, by the way.
Thank you.
Teach is on, right?
Yeah, teach is on, my friend.
Take care. All right, good luck to you. Thank you.
Well, what have we got here? Hey, that old boy's traveling with an oversized load. Yeah, I better pull him over. Gotta pull him over.
Hi, Clay. It's Connie Klinkefist for Wake Traffic in the Chopper.
And I'm Rex Kipling.
What?
Rademaker.
Hey, Kipling.
Like Run Your Kipling.
Rex Kipling.
Yeah.
Rademaker.
Yeah.
Why not Rex Run Your Rademaker?
No.
Rex.
I see it, Connie.
He's got an oversized load.
And Dink Doherty, he's right.
Dinky's right behind him.
Hey, Connie.
I copy you, Dinky.
There you are, Connie.
All right. Meanwhile, that guy's got a dangerous oversized load.
Who you calling oversized, Rademaker?
Dink.
Yes, Connie.
He's talking about the truck.
Yes.
That you're chasing.
Yes.
It's oversized.
It's oversized.
Shut up, Rademaker.
Yeah, shut up, Rex.
Rex Kipling.
Rex Kipling.
Yes.
I like it.
He likes it, Connie.
It's stupid.
Rex Kipling.
It's stupid.
How many times
have they told you
it's stupid?
And maybe
they were right.
And you were
stupid.
And you are
stupid.
And the harder
you try
to not
be stupid,
the more
stupid
you are.
And it's
not fair.
Yes, it's
not fair.
The world
out there
isn't fair.
But what are you gonna
whine?
Are you gonna
cry
like a little
baby?
Or
are you going to rise up
and show them
all
who you are
and what
you're
stinking
made of?
It's time to
grab the ball
by the balls.
Oh, you've gotta
make a move, and you
gotta make it now.
There's no
time
to wait.
The Ryerson
Triple
Threat
Program.
Don't be
stupid.
Call us
today.
The Ryerson
Triple
Threat
Program.
Looks like Rex got...
Come on, Connie.
I mean, it looks like Dink's got the oversized load pulled over.
He better watch it, Connie.
I know, Rex.
Some of those
truck drivers are
tough.
Yes.
Officer Dink Dougherty.
Approaching the suspect.
Who's motioning him forward?
With one hairy arm.
Stuck out the truck window.
Oh, God, it's like Duel.
Dink is Dennis Wheeler.
The Spielberg movie.
His best one.
Don't you start up that truck, mister. No, don't you do it. Oh, Jesus.
Dink, look out.
Yeah, look out.
Shut up, Rademacher.
Oh, Dinky, no.
Right now, about 21 minutes in front of 9. And I'm going to go to the phone for my buddy, Todd Afonik. Todd. Todd, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good. How are you doing this morning, Clay, you glorious bastard?
That is me. You nailed me there, man. I'm doing good. Short week. I had that Monday off and ready for the weekend up ahead. How about you,
yeah,
sir?
Yeah, and who toiled in your place on Monday?
Oh, geez. And
I have to admit, I did complain on the air a bit that I had not read the fine print on my personal services contract I signed with you one drunken eve.
You've been so generous filling in for me, Todd, and I know you're going to do it again, and I thanked you on the air, but I want to thank you now that I got you on the horn. Thanks so much, man, for always sitting in, and I know the listeners absolutely love it when you do it. It's always a great show. So what do you got for us for your pick of the week, Todd?
Well, today I have maybe the greatest ode ever to the weekend. It is called, in fact, Weekend. It's by The Dictators. It's off their stunning debut album, The Dictators Go Girl Crazy. And you know what is so great about The Weekend, Clay?
What's that, man?
That's when you get to hear the Todd-a-phonic Todd Show, Saturday afternoon.
That's absolutely right. I mean, when I think of The Dictators, I think of Handsome Dick Manitoba, and just always reading about them in high school in Cream magazine. They were always in there.
Yeah, that's how I first discovered them. This album was reviewed in Cream magazine by Trixie A-Bomb.
Well, let's blast this thing, man. Bring it on, Todd, and have a great weekend yourself, my friend.
Get ready for the weekend with the Dictators right now.
Time for today in history. September 5th, today in history. Happy birthday, Bob Newhart, Raquel Welch, Freddie Mercury, Michael Keaton. All you Virgos, right, Virgo? 1666, 1666, the Great Fire of London ends, leaving 13,200 houses destroyed and 8 people gone to their reward. 1698, in an effort to westernize his nobility, Tsar Peter I of Russia imposes a tax on beards for all men except clergy and peasantry. Beards!
I got a beard. I got a beard.
Ah.
I got a beard, baby. Oh, I got
Larson's got him a beard.
Yes, I got me a beard.
Got me a beard.
Got me a beard.
Do you have a beard? 1774, 12 of the 13 American colonies adopt a trade embargo against Great Britain at the First Continental Congress, Carpenter's Hall, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Continental Congress, damn it! 1836, Sam Houston elected the first president of the Republic of Texas. 1862, American Civil War, the Army of Northern Virginia crosses the Potomac River at White's Ford in the Maryland campaign. And old George Washington heaves that quarter across the Potomac. Was it a quarter? I think it was a silver dollar. Did he really do it? That's far. Or George had a hell of an arm. He had those guns, those president guns. 1975, Sacktown, California. Lynette Squeaky Fromm attempts to assassinate U.S. President Gerald Ford, one of the Manson gals. I didn't think they pronounce it Frommy, but we always said Fromm. 1775. Wow, 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 wow. WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, New York City and Rockland County, 91.9 FM online at WFMU.org. That's it for me, Clay Pigeon. See you tomorrow. It'll be Friday. It'll be the weekend up ahead. Have a great Thursday, you guys. Take care and always remember.
You've been listening to the Wake and Bake Morning Show podcast. Did you enjoy it?
Yes.
Good. It's a weekly digest of the special features and moments which make up the Wake and Bake Morning Show.
Woo!
After all, you wouldn't want to miss special moments like this.
Ah, you're in a good mood today, aren't you?
Oh!
The Wake and Bake Morning Show. Set your alarm and join us each Monday through Friday, 6 to 9 a.m. on WFMU.org. A little too early for you? Catch the archive show, which you can find easily on WFMU's homepage each day. I'm Clay Pigeon. They call me the Pigeon. Join me each morning for the full show, either on the radio or online at WFMU.org. And keep glistening.